So I'm going to present you on site measurements on six buildings around France. Sometimes we have comments saying that in hot climate it's not possible to have ventilative cooling, but it's even more important in hot climate to do some ventilative cooling, because of course it's not the same sizing as Andrés explained, like in Montpellier and Mâcon. Mâcon would be around here, for example, and Montpellier is around here. So you see, it's not exactly the same kind of climate. But it's important to both to have the possibility to improve the comfort, also sometimes to decrease the use of air conditioning for air conditioned buildings. So we have monitored an office in Toulouse, around here, and a house. We have near Marseille in Vitrolles, a day nursery. We have offices in Valence here. And in the area of Lyon, we have a dojo and some other house. So I hope I have enough time to present you the two houses, but we'll go through all the buildings just to show you the main feedback we have from these buildings. So in the office near Toulouse, the building is quite new, 2009, and we have supply and exhaust ventilation during occupation at daytime. At night, it stops and there is a motorized airing with an automatic control, but some manual override is possible, and there is a monitoring which we use for the study. The system optimization required 2 years. During this time, the occupants had to check a lot of things on their monitoring, and they noticed that the probes, some probes were not okay, some had to be changed because they were not in the correct position and so on. And during 2 years, they checked the monitoring in order to have the system running in a satisfactory point. So it took a lot of time. They have opening, the windows are opening, but there is only a 15 centimeter length to not allow people to enter, of course, and there were some bars. So they have temperature probes indoor and outdoor. They have also wind and rain probes to authorize or not the ventilative cooling. And from the initial study that was made on by modeling, they expected a decrease of temperature at night of 2 degrees. So we have checked that with ventilative cooling, they achieve almost 2 degrees at the ground floor and 2.5 at the first floor as temperature decreased during the night. And without, it was, of course, lower, 0.5 to 1.5. The potential of decrease, which is what they could achieve if they use really the potential of outdoor temperature, could be 3 to 4 degrees. So they didn't use totally their potential. They used only 60%. Still, we have some pulse both occupants, and we have noticed that they are satisfied by the system. So even if they don't use all the potential, it's not a problem. From the feedback, we really note that the control of ventilative cooling must be checked in real condition when taking over the building. And this is very often not possible, because when you take over a building, you are not, maybe it's not summer, maybe you are not in real condition. So there is a need of commissioning or something to really check how the control, how the ventilative cooling is running during summer. So that's really the problem we have. We have noticed that the temperature decrease they estimated was obtained, and the potential of decrease not achieved, but it's not a problem because occupants are satisfied. In another office building we have in Valence. Valence is midway between Lyon and Marseille. You had it on the map. The building was retrofitted in 2005, and they added a ventilative cooling with a mechanical exhaust in corridors, and it's only a time control. So they start at the defined hour, which they can change, but usually they don't. And occupants open the window when they leave office. The problem is that some occupants complain of the air too cool in the morning, and therefore they don't open so much the windows, in fact. And also they had to reduce the exhaust airflow due to neighbor complaints for the noise, and they use generally the third speed instead of the five which are possible in the installation. We have monitored four offices on the three floors, but in fact only one opened the windows regularly, and by regularly we meant 75% of the time we monitored. While the other offices, as you see, are very low, 8, 16, or even 0% of opening. The temperature decrease was good and close to the potential only in this office, of course, because if they don't open the window, they don't cool the room. That's very logical. And we also noticed that there were low temperatures in the morning, and this is due to the time control. There is no temperature control, in fact, in this installation. So the conclusion is that savings are reduced by windows closed at night. So it means that the exhaust fan runs for nothing, because it runs just for a few offices open. And also it means that there is a fan absorb power for nothing. So the EER is very low, it's 0 to 4, depending on the area and the fans. And the EER could be 7 to 10 if we have simulated if all the all the offices were open like the first one. So temperature control is needed to avoid low temperature in the morning and reduce fan absorb power for nothing. Nicolas will explain you in the next presentation that sometimes we also need some control to check that we don't let humidity enter in the building, especially for air conditioned building. In this case, it was not air conditioned and we only need a temperature control, but we will need it. Occupants awareness is very essential, especially when the system rely on occupants like here to open the window. And if you don't consider their complaints, of course they don't act as they should. And it's very logical that they don't open the window if they are not satisfied. So it's very important to check that on your system. And the decrease of temperature is correct, although the fan was limited for the noise. That was enough. Then we have the nursery in Vitrolles. Vitrolles is very close to Marseille, and it was built in 2012. They have supply and exhaust ventilation, but it stopped at night, and they have natural ventilative cooling at night. They motorized opening low and high. It's only a ground floor building, so there is not a lot of stack effect. And they have time and temperature control this time. So occupants complained of overheating, and the city hall has finally installed air conditioning just after our monitoring, which means it's too bad because they failed in having their ventilative cooling correctly. But if we look at the map to see what's happened, they have the air entering in this patio here, and the air should transfer here, and the exhaust in the higher part would be here. So you can see a few problems already on the map, is that even if they ask people to open the windows in the offices around here, it's not obvious that air will do the detour, you know, to go back in this office before going out. And of course, you feel the air transfer is not correct for those offices. So there is a real problem that those offices are not correctly handled. And finally, the ventilative cooling is only on this part of the building. Also, we have a problem because there are some doors which are closed, normally closed for fire protection, on this way. So that means, of course, the air transfer is reduced because they don't rope up as much as needed. And it's an important point to consider when you do your ventilative cooling, to check that there are not other reasons why it would be closed or things like that. The night temperature decrease was lower than the day increase, which of course means there is a problem. The building height, 2.5 meters, is too low. There is no stack effect. And the natural ventilation airflow recalculated will be 1,200 cubic meter per hour for a delta T of 5 degrees. It's not sufficient. It's less than one air change for the overall building and two air change of the transfer zone, and it's not sufficient to have a correct temperature decrease on this building. High inertia doesn't allow to decrease at least what was stocked during the day, and this is the source of the problem. One easy thing that could have been done would be to leave the exhaust from mechanical ventilation. That would have helped both help the transfer because they have exhaust in all rooms, and also that would help the natural ventilation, which is not enough. So we have simulated what would happen. Today they have just airing, so the cooling energy is 40, and the EER of course is infinite, or there is no EER because it's perfect, there is no fan at top power, but the delta T outdoor indoor in the morning is still 7 degrees. If they would keep only the ventilation flow, they could decrease this temperature by 2 degrees. But of course, what would be better would be to have higher airflow. And if they increase the airflow, they could decrease the temperature up to 3 degrees higher than outdoor. But you see that the EER is not so good. And if they want to have a good EER, they should use, of course, its motors. And they could have both a good EER and a better decrease of temperature, which maybe could have avoided to install the air conditioning, or at least to use the air conditioning too much. Then we have a dojo near Lyon. So it's a building with three rooms. And the ceiling height is 6 meters. Ventilative cooling is possible on the airline unit, but the installation was not sized for that purpose, so they didn't expect it to use ventilative cooling. The problem is that they have a high overheating during the day, and the building is used in summer only from 6 to 10 p.m. For some specific meetings. Otherwise, it's only used during the school period. So the problem is that they wanted to try to use the ventilative cooling of the unit to improve the case because it was not very good. And for the summer 2015, we replaced the self-regulating dampers by standard dampers to allow the increase of flow. And we replaced some diffusers, ATDs, which were horizontal with 6 meter height. It's better than the air goes down, so we replaced by vertical supply. We measured 3,400 cubic meter per hour in occupation and 1,000 when not occupied. That was the design requirement. But the only unit should go 4,500. So we, as you can see, we didn't get the maximum airflow that was possible. And the only unit control with night cooling was set up from 10 p.m. to 7 in the morning. And the night cooling didn't start some nights because the army unit control is very complicated, and there are a lot of things about the temperature, if it starts, if it doesn't start, and so on. And we noticed that some nights it will be better that it will start, but it didn't. So comfort was improved in the morning with ventilative cooling. because we have only 5% unsatisfied in the morning, while we have 50% in the evening. And the temperature decrease of is only 35% of potential, so it's not very, it's not a lot, but it's enough in the morning. The problem is that we noticed very quickly that the temperature increased that day very, very quickly. So you can see, for example, in this night, we have a decrease of temperature during the night indoor due to the fact it decreased outdoor. We have poorly used the potential, so we are still very far from outdoor temperature. But then when outdoor it starts to increase, we also start to increase very, very quickly. And this is due to the low inertia of the building, but also the high airflow. So in summer 2016, we changed and we used CO2 demand control ventilation. So the purpose here was not for winter savings, but it was to reduce the temperature increase because otherwise during the day they have more than 3,000 cubic meter per hour of outdoor air coming in, and this helps the building gaining temperature. And it's not used really used because they don't use the building all the day. They use it only at night in summer, and it's too bad because they don't change the time control. So they have to. So we thought it was better to use only airflow only if it was really occupied. We also improved the duct to reduce pressure drop because, as you can see, it was not there were some elbows and it was not perfect. We also asked them to change the filters because they didn't from the beginning, and as you can see, it was needed. So the airflow increased to 4,500, which was what we expected from the handling unit. And we corrected and analyzed the control defaults. So finally, what happened, we can see it on the curve. In 2015, for example, in a typical summer day, we had increased ventilation at night. Then during the day, it decreased to standard occupation airflow. And the next night, we don't know why, because here outdoor temperature and indoor temperature were slightly lower, but it decided not to go to, again, ventilative cooling, and it stopped here. And finally, we have this curve. The red curve is indoor temperature in the building. And a typical day similar in 2016, we had ventilative cooling higher because we increased the flow the night before. Then we stopped during the day and we go to the minimum airflow. And then we start earlier the night ventilation at 5 p.m. because they start the meeting at 6. So it's not very efficient because at 5 p.m. the temperature is lower than outdoor temperature start to be lower, but not very much. It's almost the same temperature. And then we have this night cooling. So we saved 2 degrees during the day versus 2015, so it was better from the comfort. We have some savings in absorbed power, and the temperature decrease, the potential was only 35% in 2015, and we went up to 86% of the potential in 2016. Yet, we decreased the EER because the average, sorry, it's not translated, it's average. The average EER in 2015 was 2.5, and we decreased to 1.1 because as we have an early start of the ventilative cooling, it's not very efficient from the energy point of view. We have very low temperature difference. People feel it better because there is some hair moving and it's slightly more fresh, so it's important for them and they prefer that. But from the energy point of view, you have the fan absorb power for that, which is not very good. This is for the beginning of the period, and that during the night it comes to be better, but then at the end our average EER is not so good. So night ventilation was improved by optimizing control and to adapt with the specific use of this building only in the evening. But ventilative cooling must be planned when sizing installation, because once your ducts are sized and they are not made for high airflow, it's hard to change that. There is a need to take over and check control in real condition. And energy savings due to fan absorb power with CO2 control were seen. Very shortly, we have two houses that were monitored. One near Toulouse was built in 2015 with balanced supply and exhaust ventilation. And there is a bypass of the heat recovery and increase of airflow at night for ventilation. So you have the airflows here, and they have three airflow possible. The ER was good, but it's an insufficient airflow in this case to achieve comfort. This is due to the dampers we use in France, self-regulating. We have difficulty to increase more than the boost airflow. Otherwise, we need to use specific devices. We used almost 50% of the potential of decrease. We could do better if we could increase the airflow. Night temperature, they stepped up two degrees, 2.3 degrees. And especially it's important to have higher airflow in the bedrooms. If we can't increase the airflow in all the house, it's important to increase at least in the bedrooms. Then we have an individual house with air conditioning near Lyon. It's an individual house, quite old, but it's retrofitted with insulation and shutters in 2012. It's already air conditioned with a heat pump, and a supply unit was installed in the main bedroom with airflow that can go quite high from the volume of the room, from 25 to 225 cubic meter per hour, and it's controlled by a CPL control. Usually it's a time control, but there is an occupant horizon TV, so the occupant can play on the CPL and change. It allows to shut off air conditioning at night and reduce energy consumption. And in fact, we have three periods during the monitoring. There was a heat wave, a very short heat wave, 7 days, you know, of heat wave. So we see what happens when temperature at night doesn't decrease that much. Then we have standard summer mechanical night ventilation, which is the system itself as planned. And we have some airing because the CPL had a breakdown. It was sometimes after the heat wave, so I don't know if there is a link. And we can see the average airflow. So during the heat wave, the occupant increased very much the airflow in the room, and even more than needed just to maintain temperature. And it was just a need to feel air moving in the room, in fact. So it's not really efficient from the energy point of view. And therefore, during this time, it decreased the EER. And also, during the heat wave, the time control of the CPL was adapted to start later and later. But it was always, as it was not automatic from the temperature, it was always too late, in fact. During the heat wave, you really temperature decrease at night is late and late and late every day, and it's important not to start night ventilation too early. During standard days, so the average EER is 13, so it's okay. And the energy saving calculated is here. And the air conditioning used in the building was only half a day, while in the heat wave it was during all day time it was used. So we can see that the fact to have ventilative cooling helps to not use air conditioning too much in the day. But there is a limit, and if it's really there is not enough potential, which is the case in the heat wave period. Of course, you can't decrease anymore this temperature. During the airing period, the average airflow was lower. It was calculated from CO2 measurements. But of course, the ER is not calculated, but it's infinite. And the air conditioning at day is very similar. And also, we don't give it here, but the temperature in the room was very similar as the mechanical ventilation. And then you have the average on the period. So in conclusion, on this house, night ventilation reduced the air conditioning use at night and generally in the morning. But occupant override has not been the best energy choice because it went to too high airflow during the heat wave. This need of having speed and air moving around. And starts too early when temperature decreases late at night because it was better that if the occupant had kept only the time control, but it was not enough. A temperature control would have been much better.